Blackstone Publishing presents The Boy Crisis, Why Our Boys Are Struggling, and What We Can Do About It, by Warren Farrell, Ph.D., and John Gray, Ph.D. This book is read by Warren Farrell, Ph.D., and John Gray, Ph.D. I am dedicating this book to my wonderful wife, Liz, my sister, Gail, my daughters, Alex and Erin, my son-in-law, Hutch, and my grandson, just born, Finley.
To my wife, Bonnie Gray, for 30 years of her devoted love and support, I also want to thank our three daughters and their partners, Shannon and John, Juliet and Dan, and Lauren and Glade, and our adorable grandchildren, Sophia, Beau, Brady, and McKenna.
Introduction. Is there really a boy crisis? I am sorry for being a man. David Cunliffe, New Zealand leader of the Labour Party, 2014. In the middle of an invigorating dinner conversation involving a former governor, a minister, an owner of a PR firm, two authors, and a UC Berkeley professor, three men, three women, two strong feminists, one of the hosts, author Sam Keane, asks, if you were born today, which would you rather be, a boy or a girl? Every man answered, a girl, as did two of the three women. At another dinner party, Melissa, the daughter of close friends, told my wife Liz and I that she was pregnant. I asked her husband, Andy, what he looked forward to if their child were a boy. Andy's eyes lit up. When he's a baby, I look forward to lifting him real high and rolling around with him. I guess I mostly think about him being a little older and us roughhousing and playing ball. And I can't wait to teach him how to fish and to play soccer. I remember when my dad pretended to let me kick a ball past him and score a goal. The first thing I yelled to Mom when we got home was how I beat Dad. I want to do that for him. Later that evening, I asked Andy, if you had to choose, which would you prefer, a boy or girl? After a second's hesitation, he said in a serious tone, a girl. Today a girl. When I asked why, he was matter of fact. Girls today can be whatever they want to be. Guys can't. And I'm more afraid a boy would screw up in school or get buried in video games, stuff like that. Of course, girls still face cultural biases, both external and internal. But I was struck that despite Andy's powerful fantasy of playing with a son, his desire for his child to have the best possible life trumped his fantasy of what he could contribute to it, and thus a daughter became his choice. In the past, most dads wanted their first child to be a son. No longer. Andy's deeper fatherhood instinct, wanting what is best for his child over what he wants for himself, is in sync with what most dads wish for today. Dads-to-be are almost twice as likely to prefer a daughter to a son. As for moms-to-be, they are 24% more likely to prefer their firstborn child to be a daughter. In the past, most of us would have imagined that daughters would be more likely to move back in with their parents as adults than sons, because that was reality. No longer. Today, young men between 25 and 31 are 66% more likely than their female counterparts to be living with their parents. For the first time in recent history, young men are more likely to live with their parents than with a partner. In contrast, women are more likely to live with a partner. Kevin's dad, William, told me, when Kevin moved back to his childhood room shortly after we gave him a wonderful 30th birthday party, I can remember thinking to myself, this is proof that I've failed as a dad. I never said this to Kevin, but it still haunts me. Kevin nevertheless picked up on his dad's shame. And yet something bothered Kevin even more. This girl and I were flirting something fierce at a party. I wanted to ask her to leave with me, but I couldn't invite her back to my parents' home, so I just kept flirting. Finally, she says it. It's so noisy in here. Should we go somewhere else? So I suggest a bar. She looks at me like something's wrong with me. Then her eyes became seductive, and she ran her finger over the buttons on my shirt and says, maybe your place? You live near here? I said I did, but that I live with my parents. I wanted to ask if she had a place we could go to, but I saw how the second I said I live with my parents, her body language froze. She excused herself to, quote, go to the ladies' room, and when she came out, she walked over to a girlfriend, and they both started sneaking glances over at me and laughing. I don't ever remember feeling more humiliated. On the opposite end of the productivity spectrum is the boy who is highly motivated. What do he and Kevin have in common? Sensitivity. And shame. Amid an atmosphere of Me Too's, Bill Cosby's, Harvey Weinstein's, and other fallen icons, each newly revealed sexual harasser, rapist, and serial killer leaves a sensitive boy feeling ashamed that he's a male. You can feel the shame that Royce Mann has absorbed by age 15, as expressed in this excerpt of his 2017 prose poem, Performed for Hatch, which is a global community designed to, quote, hatch creativity. He says, recently, I became a man. It happened the first time a woman avoided me on the sidewalk. When the woman 10 feet in front of me glanced back, she changed direction, crossing the street like Moses did the Red Sea. Her footsteps taught me the danger of my own hands, taught me what it truly means to be a man, though I may never know what it means to fear one. You know, in that moment, I finally understood Peter Pan. You see, I wanted to stay a boy, not become a man, because a man, as I now knew, was a mix between a father, brother, and attacker, mostly the latter. The shame Royce has already absorbed by age 15 teaches him, quote, the danger of my own hands. His primary view of male identity is someone who is feared. His conclusion, I wanted to stay a boy, a Peter Pan, because a man is, quote, mostly an, quote, attacker. You can just feel the shame, and this is from a brilliant boy. The good news, Royce is unlikely to be a sexual harasser. But in no part of Royce's talk did he discuss the healthy aspects of masculinity that he looked forward to contributing to his family and the world. Feeling like he is programmed to increasingly become an attacker will limit his contributions to those motivated by guilt. Whether a Kevin or a Royce, your son is growing up at a time when an article in The Atlantic titled The End of Men so resonated with you.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.